he was given the title Al-Amin, the trustworthy one. And Abu Ubaidah, the trustworthy one, knew, though Abu Bakr is putting him forward and putting Umar forward, they are not the rightful leaders. Abu Bakr is the rightful leader. Thus Abu Ubaidah and Umar put Abu Bakr forward, explaining his virtues, and that he was ثاني اثنين إذهما في الغار, the second of the two when they were in the cave. And he was the one when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at all times and all the difficult moments, and he was the one that led the prayer in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It didn't make a difference to him whether he was the Amir or whether he was just a soldier. In all circumstances, he behaved in exactly the same manner. And we will look at the different traditions, we will find this is because he was a very down to earth and a very humble man. When an army unit was dispatched in the charge of Amr ibn al-As, Amr ibn al-As asked Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, okay, whether he would be in charge of the whole Muslim army. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu explained that Abu Ubaidah will be in charge of everyone, and he will only be in charge of those that are leaving with him. Amr ibn al-As remained quiet. He later approaches Umar and mentions how good he was in the battlefield and his status in the eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he would appreciate it if Umar talks to Abu Bakr and tells Abu Bakr to put him in charge. And that he was very hopeful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless him with victory. Sayyid Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu declined, explained that Abu Ubaidah was far superior to him. And thus it was not appropriate, even though if the leadership were in Amr's hands, it wouldn't decrease the rank of Abu Ubaidah. Amr left in this condition, and when he met with Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, look at the way Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu welcomes him. Listen to what Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu says to him. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, "Yo Amr, the reins of leadership may be in my hands, but remember, in reality, I am just a man from amongst you, and I will not decide anything without consulting you. So please do not deprive me of your opinion, as Abu Ubaidah cannot do without you." This was Abu Ubaidah. Urwat ibn Zubair relates, when Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to Sham, and the Muslim generals came to receive him, the first thing that Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked was, "Okay, where is my brother?" The Sahaba asked, "O Amir al-Mu'mineen, who are you referring to?" He mentioned Abu Ubaidah. They explained, "Okay, Abu Ubaidah will be coming." When Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu came, he alighted and embraced him. And then Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu went with him to his house. And when he entered his house, he was surprised that he could see nothing other than his sword, his shield, and his saddle. And he asked him as to where his furniture was and things were. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu explained, "Ki Umir al-Mu'mineen, this is enough to take me to my grave." In another narration it is mentioned that Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was amazed when he saw that there is nothing inside his house. And he said to Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, "Yo Abu Ubaidah, you are the Amir, you are the leader of the Muslims, you're the general, and this is all you have inside your house. Then Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was thinking that he may not have any food, ask Yo Abu Ubaidah, do you have any food? Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu stands to a pot, and he takes out a few old pieces, and he shows them to Umar. And when Umar sees this, tears begin to flow from Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu's eyes. And Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu remarks, "Ki Abu Ubaidah, the world has changed every one of us and deceived us, but the world has not changed you." This was the condition of the Muslim general who conquered many a land. Abu Huzaifa relates in Futuh al-Sham that once the Romans sent a messenger to Abu Ubaidah that we would like to send somebody to you who will present what we have to offer. And if you accept his proposal, this will be good for you and us. And if you do not, then you, the Muslims, will be in a loss. Abu Ubaidah told them to send whoever they like. They sent a very tall man with a reddish complexion. You know, he approached the Muslims, he did not know who Abu Ubaidah was. When he asked the believers, where is your Amir? They pointed to Abu Ubaidah and said, this is our Amir. Now at the time Abu Ubaidah was sitting on the ground, on the floor. He was wearing his armor and holding the reins of his horse. And at the same time he had some arrows in his hands which he was turning. Now the man was amazed, this is the Muslim Amir sitting on the floor. And he asked again, are you the Amir? Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala replied, yes, I'm the Amir. He asked, ma yujlisuka al-ard, what makes you sit on the floor? If you were to sit on a couch, would that loathe you in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala replied, inna Allah la yastahi min al-haq. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not ashamed of speaking the truth. And today I will tell you the truth. This is all I have in my possession. My sword, my horse, and my arms. I have nothing other than this. Yesterday I was in need of some money. I took a loan from my brother, referring to Mu'adh ibn Jabal. If I had a couch, then I would not sit on it, making my brothers sit on the ground. We are all the servants of Allah. We walk on this earth. We sit on this earth. We eat on this earth. And we sleep on it. And this does not decrease us in the eyes of Allah. On the contrary, it elevates our ranks in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I guess it was because of this. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu would wish only if he had more people like Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. One day, Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to his companions, "Kitamannaw, make a wish." One of them said, "Ki O Amir al-Mu'mineen, atamanna لو أن هذه الدار مملوءة ذهبا أنفقه في سبيل الله. I wish if this house was full of gold so I could spend it all in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala said again, "Tamannaw, wish." This time one of the companions said, "I wish if this house was full of rubies and diamonds so I could give a sadaqah and spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Again, Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, "Kitamanna, wish." They said, "Ki Umir al-Mu'mineen, ma nadri ma nakul." We've said everything, we do not know what to say. This time Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, "Ki lakinni atamanna law anna hadhihi ad-dar mamlu'atan rijalan mithl Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah." "I wish if only this house was full of men, the likes of Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu." As for when Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu embraced Islam and what he looked like, I'd like to mention here that his name was not Abu Ubaidah. This was his title. His name was Amir, the son of Abdullah, the son of Jarrah. And his mother was Amima binti Ghunaym. I mentioned earlier that his father did not embrace Islam and his father was killed by the sons of Abu Ubaidah in the Battle of Badr. As for what he looked like, Malik ibn Yukhamir describes him as being رَجُلًا طَوِيلًا نَحِيفًا خَفِيفَ اللِّحْيَةً, that he was tall and slim with a light beard and he had a slight humpback and his front two teeth were missing. أَسُمَ الثَّنِيَتَيْنِ, he would apply mainly to his head and beard. And the inscription on his ring was Al-Khumsu Lillah, that a fifth is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu was from amongst the Sabiqeen al-Awwaleen, from the first group of people that embraced Islam. He had heard the talk of Makkah al-Mukarrama, that Muhammad the son of Abdullah claims to be a prophet and claims that he receives revelation from the heavens. And that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his friend and companion, has taken this to be true, and he also believes in Allah, and he takes Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the messenger of Allah. He also knew that his own people, the people of Makkah, have rejected him. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu wanted to find out the reality of this deen for himself. He went to Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu's house. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu had a lengthy chat with him, explaining the reality of this deen and the beauty of this deen. And the majlis concluded with this, that they will meet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tomorrow. Now next day, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala realized that a few other people had the same intentions. And they also wanted to meet Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Ubaidah, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Uthman ibn Maz'un, and Abu Salma ibn Abd al-Asad left while it was still dark to meet Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained this new religion. Happy with what they heard from Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They all declared, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. We believe in the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we take Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the true messenger of Allah. He embraced Islam. And at the same time, he participated in all the battles with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was under his leadership when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een came across the Amr in one of the expeditions. What happened was, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dispatched towards the seashore an expedition of 300 men under the command of Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He gave them a bag full of dates for their rations. Now within a matter of days, they ran short of rations. And because of this, Qais began buying camels from his own men to feed the Mujahideen, and he promised them that he will pay them on return to Madinah al-Munawwara. Now the Amir, seeing that if Qais keeps on buying the camels and slaughtering them like this, they will deprive them of their only means of transport. So the Amir stopped him from doing this. He then collected the dates that had been left with each person and he stored them in one bag. And every day he would give them one date to chew and suck on. And when no dates remained, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala ajma'een, the narration suggests that they lived on leaves. They would moisten dry leaves with water and they would eat them. One day Allah, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came. And as they were traveling, a big fish known as the Amber, and I guess it was probably a whale, was thrown out of sea for them. It was so big that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een lived on it for 20 days. Can you imagine? 300 Sahaba they were, 300 men, and they ate from this fish, huge fish, for 20 days. And the narration suggests that they also filled their satchels with the remaining portion. And this lasted them right till they reached Madinah al-Munawwara. And they related this incident to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said this was provision which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. In the battle of Uhud, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the one, okay, when the two rings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's iron ringed helmet got stuck in Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face. It was Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu who received the honor of that on that day of taking them out. And as a result of this, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu had lost his front two teeth. Ummi Amara, describing this scene, relates, okay, I left in the early part of the day and I had with me a water bottle. I wanted to see, okay, what was happening. She says, I reached Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala al-Majma'in with his companions. And at the beginning of the battle, everything was going in the favor of the Muslims. However, when the Muslims dispersed, she says, I myself began to fight and shoot arrows till I was injured. She says Abu Dujana that day had become a human shield protecting the person of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Arrows were falling on Abu Dujana's back. She also says, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Talha and others also did the same. She says then the rumor was spread that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been killed. Now when Ka'b ibn Malik saw this, he called aloud from the top of his voice, O believers, Glad tidings. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not died. This is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Ka'b to be quiet. When the believers saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all the believers came and made their way to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu held Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by the hand. And Sayyidina Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu held him till Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to stand straight. Malik ibn Sinan took the blood from Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face. While Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu took out one of the rings. And as a result of this, one of his tooth fell out. Then Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, though Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu wanted to take out the second ring, again Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu requested and begged Abu Bakr, allow me to do this. He took out the other ring, and as a result of this, his second tooth fell. This is when Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu lost his front two teeth. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to say, كَمَا رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا أَهْتَمْ أَجْمَلْ وَلَا أَحْسَنْ شَكْلًا مِنْ أَبِي أُبَيْدَةَ. That he would say, that I have never seen anyone with no two front teeth more handsome and more good looking than Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is what he did in the Battle of Uhud. In the Battle of Laziqiyah, he did something incredible. Now Laziqiyah had a strong fort with high walls, and it was in such a position that even if the Muslims laid siege, it would have no impact because it received provisions via the sea route. Now when the Muslims got close to Laziqiyah, the Kuffar closed the doors. The Muslims lay a siege. But just as the Muslims feared, it had no impact. There was no benefit because they were receiving their provisions via the sea route, and they could remain like this for years. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala began to think and plan as to what should be done. After a long hard thing, he came out with this idea that they will dig holes and they will take their horses and hide inside these holes. When the Romans see that there is no one there, the Romans will think that the Muslims have left, and then the Romans will open the doors and they will come. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala, this is exactly what he did. He put the plan into practice, and by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the plan worked. The Romans saw and assumed, when the Romans saw that there is no one there, they assumed that the Muslims have left. So they opened the gates and came out in their fields and began to work. The Muslims surprised them and attacked them and conquered them. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala was a very clever man, very clever man. From this you can see how clever he was. On one occasion, when the enemy had an upper hand, and a siege was laid, and Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was informed, Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote a letter to Abu Ubaidah, in which basically he was explaining that after every difficulty comes ease. And he related the verse of the Quran, كَيَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اصْبِرُوا وَصَابِرُوا وَرَابِطُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. The verse which orders the believers to be patient and steadfast. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he received this letter, he wrote back, writing down the verse of the Quran, اِعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَهُ, which explains that this worldly life is nothing but amusement and play, and this worldly life is deception. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu understood immediately to what Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu was referring to. He took the letter of Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu and read it on the minbar before the people, saying, كِيَا أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ إِنَّمَا يُعَرِّضُ بِكُمْ أَبُو عُبَيْدَةَ أُوْبِي. O people of Medina, Abu Ubaidah is hinting to you or hinting to me, so all of you prepare for jihad. Many a city he conquered. It is stated in the books of tarikh history that Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu conquered around 28 cities. He conquered Damascus, Ba'alabak, Hims, He conquered Lazikiya. He conquered Halb. He conquered Intaqiya. He conquered Jazeera. He conquered Haran. He conquered Ruha. He conquered many of the cities. All his life, he spent elevating the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till he finally left this world dying from the plague of Amwas. Now Amwas is a town in Palestine, and it is from this place that the plague started, and then it spread in Syria and Jordan and other lands. This was the same year Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to Sham. When Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu reached a place called Sar, the Muslims generals came to receive him. And they informed Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu of the plague. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu consulted the Muhajirin and Ansar. And two opinions were expressed, two different opinions. Some people expressed that Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu should continue, while others expressed that Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu should return with his companions and not proceed. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu chose the latter. He chose to return. At that point, Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu remarked, "Ya Umir al-Mu'minin, afirar min qadrillah?" O Amir al-Mu'minin, are you running away from taqdeer? Are you running away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined? Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu explained, yes. Naam, nafirru min qadrillah ila qadrillah. That I am running from the qadr of Allah to the qadr of Allah. I am running from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is destined to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is destined. And then he explained to Abu Ubaidah, Abu Ubaidah, if you were to enter a valley which had land, which was rich and fertile, and at the same time it had land which was barren, and if you were to graze your animals in any one of the two pieces of land, would that not be with the qadr of Allah and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined? O Abu Ubaidah, only if somebody other than you had said this. Abu Ubaidah understood. At the time, Abdul Rahman ibn Awf radiallahu ta'ala was not present. He had gone somewhere. When he came and he was informed of the situation, he explained that he knew the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to this. And the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to this were that if you hear there is a plague in some land, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ بِهِ بِأَرْضِ قَوْمٍ فَلَا تَكْدُمُوا عَلِهِ, then you should not come. وَإِذَا وَقَعَ بِأَرْضٍ وَأَنْتُمْ فِيهَا فَلَا تَخْرُجُوا فِرَارًا مِنْ, and if it starts while you are already there, then you should not leave that place running away from that plague. When Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu heard this, he praised the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having made the correct decision, and Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu returned. In one of the narration it is mentioned that Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote to Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu telling him that a matter has risen and he would like to confront Abu Ubaidah in person. And as soon as he receives this letter of Umar, he should come. Now Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala understood as to why the Amir al-Mu'mineen was calling him. So he wrote a letter back explaining that he knew as to why he was being called. And he explained that he does not find it appropriate to leave his Muslim brethren in this condition, and that he will remain with his Muslim brethren till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfills what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined with regards to him and them. When Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu read the letter, tears began to flow from Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu's eyes. The people asked, "Ya Umar, has Abu Ubaidah died?" Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu would reply, "No." But just assume that he has died. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu then wrote another letter ordering him to take the people to high open good land. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu carried out the order of the Amir al-Mu'mineen, and as he was about to mount his camel, he was struck. He caught the illness. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu would pray, "Ki Allahumma nasibaka fi ali Abi Ubaidah. Oh Allah, give a share of this to the family of Abu Ubaidah." A pimple came out on his finger. He would look at it, and it was said to him, "This is nothing." He would reply, Okay, I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts barakat in it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts barakat in something that is less, it becomes a lot. In his illness, he called the Muslims and instructed them that if they were to accept his advice, then they would always remain good. They gathered around him and he told them, Ya Muslims, أَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةِ وَصُومُوا شَهْرَ رَمَضَانِ وَتَصَدَّقُوا وَحَجُّوا وَاعْتَمِرُوا. Okay, offer your prayers, give your zakah, fast in the month of Ramadan, give sadaqah, donate in the path of Allah, perform hajj, go for umrah, be faithful and sincere to your leaders. Let not this world destroy you. Do not betray and deceive your leaders. And then he explained, okay, even if a man is given life for 1,000 years, one day he will meet his end. Just like as Abu Ubaidah is now meeting his end. He explained, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written death on the children of Adam. They will all die one day. The wisest from amongst them is he who is the most obedient to his Lord and the one that practices and performs the most deeds. Wassalamu alaykum, and peace be upon you. O Muaz, lead the prayer. Saying this, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu left this world to meet his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He died in the 18th year of Hijrah. And at the time, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu was 58 years of age. Sayyidina Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu led the funeral prayer, the janazah, while Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Dhahhak laid him to rest in his grave. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahu says that the grave of Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu is in Jordan near a village called Amta. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhu had 2 children, Umair and Yazid. I conclude by saying, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to model our lives and live our lives just like the way our Salafus Saliheen lived. Allah give me the tawfiq to act upon what I've said. Allah give you the tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.